chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany across the Jordan where John was baptizing. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. We continue with the children's message.
Good morning. I welcome any of our young people that want to come forward. If you're wondering if you should come forward, I have treats. Right? Sometimes whatever we need to do, we do, right? So, come on up. Oh, yes, come on over. Yeah, okay. So, anybody tell me what day it is in the church? We talked about it at the very beginning. Pastor Denny welcomed us, and how many candles do we have lit? Three. So it is the third Sunday in Advent, right? Okay. And how many more weeks till Christmas if we're on the third Sunday?
A little bit more than a week.
Yeah, like a week and a day, right? If we count today, it's a week and a day till Christmas. But we will celebrate next Sunday, right? The fourth Sunday of Advent and Christmas Eve. Doesn't always happen that way in the calendar, but this year it did. So the third Sunday of Advent is known as Joy Sunday. Any guesses why it might be Joy Sunday? To a lot of the grown-ups in the room, it's probably not very joyful, right? As we realize there are 7 days left, right? Yeah. So, but Joy Sunday is because there's only 1 week left, okay? Because we're getting so much closer to Christmas, to whose birthday? Jesus, that's right, yes. And in some churches, the third candle on the Advent wreath would be the color pink. But it doesn't matter what color it is, it's always joy. But I have pink glow sticks for everybody, okay? You wanna take one and pass them around, okay? So the pink glow sticks to help us remember that this week is about joy. Now, tell me, is it easy to be joyful when we are in a week of waiting? Maybe not, right? Who can be patient one more week? Anybody? Well, we have to be patient one more week, right? Right? So, this is why we have our pink glow sticks, to remind us of joy, right? To remind us of joy and that Jesus, the real light, is coming in 1 week. And that's why this third week is joy. Do you think you can help your grown-ups be joyful this week? Remind them of the pink light of joy, right? Ooh, those are bright. Some of them have cracked them already, and they're very bright. So, okay, so your job this week is to remember these pink glow sticks, to remember the candle of joy, right? For this, we're almost there. We're almost there, okay? Can we say our prayer? Okay, you can repeat after me. So fold your hands. Dear God, help us celebrate with joy this third Sunday of Advent. Help us wait with smiling faces for the miracle of Jesus' birth. And give us a little more patience too. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to worship, all gathered here and all gathered online as well. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus, the risen Christ. Amen. Years ago, I shared with you the story of little Tommy, and I'd like to start again today on this third Advent with that same story. Little Tommy is probably about 30 now, but true story. And I want you to imagine this and picture this in your mind as I share what little Tommy did. It was getting close to Christmas, and little Tommy was really excited. He was really, really pumped up. He ran to his mom and dad and said, "Mom, Dad, you gotta come and see this. You gotta come and see this right now." So mom and dad followed little Tommy to the spare room, where on the table in the middle of the room was the most bizarre nativity setup they had ever seen. For a stable, Tommy had opened an old Dukes of Hazzard lunchbox. Dukes of Hazzard lunchbox. Half walls were built of Legos on either side. There was even an arched doorway. The thermos was sitting next to the open lunchbox, kind of like the turret of a castle. And on the top of the thermos was none other than Darth Vader, with his arms spread wide open as the angel of the Lord. Okay? Along one side, behind the fence from his farm set, all neatly spaced and set in as reverent a posture as possible, were Frankenstein, the Wolfman, and Mummy action figures. And of course, they were the three wise men from the East. And I would imagine Frankenstein had the frankincense, and Wolfman had the gold, and the Mummy had to have the myrrh, just imagining. But there they were, right? Each with a small gift box in front of them. On the other side, behind a Lego fence, with a gate surrounded by several Beanie Babies, all right, Care Bear figurines, and assorted other stuffed animals as the sheep and livestock, were a Star Wars Wookiee, the Cat in the Hat, and the Hulk and Batman as the shepherds. On the lid of the lunchbox sat his sister's Barbie in a classic Rapunzel outfit as Mary. And standing behind Mary, leaning against the side of the lunchbox for stability and playing Joseph, was G.I. Joe dressed up in his battle regalia. And the crowning piece was Bart Simpson in a shopping cart as the baby Jesus. All right? Now, surrounding all this were his Toy Story characters, all the rest of his action figures. They were spectators. Others were the heavenly hosts singing hallelujah to the newborn king. Imagine this. It was truly a sight to behold. Mom and Dad had to do everything in their power to keep from laughing hysterically about it all. It was obvious. It was obvious from the look on Tommy's face that he had spent hours and hours planning exactly which character would take on which role and where to place them all. Who knows what he was thinking when he selected Bart Simpson in a shopping cart as the baby in a manger, but that's something else. But you know what made this wondrous, what made this even perfect, was Tommy's love for Jesus and for Christmas. That was the cool thing about all this. And the burning desire in his heart to run to Mom and Dad with the invitation, come and see. Come and see this. Come and see this great thing, Mom and Dad. Today, the third Sunday in Advent, we have our second Sunday in a row where we see John the Baptist. And in some ways, he's as strange a character in the whole thing as Bart Simpson is. Yet John comes with a powerful message. The Advent message, and we've been talking about it, to get ready, to prepare the way of the Lord. Now, you and I, we get ready. We prepare for all kinds of things in life, right? We prepare for weddings and childbirth and job interviews. Some of us like to be spontaneous. Some of us love surprises. Some of us not so much. Either way, we like to be prepared. Prepared for the big thing. So when it comes to Advent and to Christmas, what does this preparedness look like? What is going on in our heart of faith that allows us to receive the wondrous gift of Christmas once again anew in our hearts and our minds? Our second lesson for today, which we did not share a moment ago, but it's a second lesson in our lectionary, is Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, verses 16 to 24. And whenever I read that passage, I think of a beloved member of our congregation who passed away a number of years ago. Some of you might remember her, Carol Saltzman. Carol Saltzman. And when I sat down with her before her funeral, to plan her funeral, because she knew she was dying, we were talking about hymns and things like that, and she said, "But you know, Pastor Tim, the one thing we have to make sure, you have to make sure is in the service, is my go-to passage from Scripture, my favorite passage in all the Bible." And I said, "Well, Carol, what passage is that?" She said, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 to 24. She said, "It keeps me focused. It's the one that fills my heart with heart and peace and what God has done for us and for me, and what God is doing now, what God will do in the future." This is what 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 through 24 says. You ready? "Be joyful always. Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you." To sanctify means to be made holy. "Sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it." He will do it. Rejoicing always. Deacon Diane talked about third Sunday in Advent. It's the Sunday of joy, right? Be joyful always. Rejoice always. Not just when we feel like it or when we're in a happy mood for whatever reason, when circumstances in life lift us up. Not just then. Well, what about rejoicing when things aren't so great? Rejoicing when we're mourning. Rejoicing when we're overwhelmed. Rejoicing when we feel burdened. Rejoicing when we're stressed or anxious or fearful. What about rejoicing then? The Lord is always with us and in our midst. And I found that, I look back on Carol and I'm just continually amazed. In that moment, her eyes lit up and she said, rejoice always, even in the midst of this. Rejoice always. Pray continually. Pray continually. This isn't like being on our knees 24/7. It's realizing that every moment in our lives that we are in the presence of the Lord. You are in God's presence. I'm in God's presence every moment of our lives, 24/7. So it's a running conversation when we talk about praying constantly, right? It's a dynamic relationship. It's always tuned in to God's frequency in Christ Jesus. It's living moment by moment in the light of Christ. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. In all circumstances, give thanks. Thank you, Lord. Not just when times are good or times are easy, but again, in the painful times, in the difficult times, even in the tragic times, especially then. Why? Because it keeps us focused on God's love and care. The one who calls you is faithful and he will do it. He will do it. The assurance that Emmanuel comes to be with us and for us. The birth of this child, the Savior, is about finding our way back home, or better yet, being found and brought back. Have you ever been lost? Have you ever been lost? And it might have been when we were kids, right? Have you ever been lost? I've been lost. Remember that feeling? I've been lost twice in my life physically, both when I was a little kid. One was in the middle of the woods. It was a family reunion, New Burlington, Ohio, which is now Caesar Creek Reservoir, if you know that area around Xenia and whatnot. We were there at our Quaker church. My mom's relatives were Quakers, believe it or not. And so we were having this family reunion, huge woods beside the church, right? My cousins who lived on a farm in Xenia and were older than me by 2-3 years decided they were going to get the city slicker, lost in the woods. So they took me in the middle of the woods, left me there. And I'm looking around, Jeff, Bruce, where are you? Nowhere to be found. And there I am in the middle of the woods. The best part of that was when, you know, the family found me. They went hunting for me because they came back from the woods and without me, right? And so the best part of the rest of that family reunion was watching them get punished. They couldn't, you know, they couldn't. Anyway, that's, there you go. That's revenge is mine, saith the Lord. But it was fun watching that. Anyway, so in the woods, the second time I was lost was in downtown Lazarus. You remember downtown Lazarus? When it was at its prime, I was lost there. But the thing is, I was found both times. I mean, I was found both times. But you know, when you're lost, you're not thinking about being found because you think life is over. Especially when you're little like that. You think, oh, I'm never going to be found. It's going to be, you know, and so the feeling in your stomach is kind of hollow. It goes right up to your throat. Your knees get weak and, my life is over. There have been times in my life when I've been lost after that, not physically, but spiritually, right? And the panic's just as real. Being lost in a dark world isn't much fun, is it? But Christmas shows us that God never gives up the search for us. He never gives up the search for us to bring us home. You know, Psalm 23, I'm convinced, is a Christmas psalm. Psalm 23 is a Christmas psalm. Yea, though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art what? With me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Emmanuel. Christmas, Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. So that's one. Later on in the psalm, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The word for follow in Hebrew is to pursue. So surely goodness and mercy
shall pursue me all the days of my life. Now, when I think of follow, I think kind of a passive, I'm following Doug. Not quite sure where he's going to go. But pursue means what? To track down, to chase down, right? God pursues you. That's what, Christmas is a rescue mission. Christmas is a rescue mission. It's God pursuing you to the very end. I told my kids growing up, whenever they'd get in trouble or they want to break from God or whatever it was, I'd say, well, that's fine and good. But how far do you want God to go to get your attention? Because here's the thing, God is not going to let you go. Everybody else might fail you, everybody else might drop the ball, but God's gonna get you. Why? Because God's pursuing you and me. He doesn't let us go without a fight. And even then, he doesn't let us go, right? Christmas is God's rescue mission to us and for us. There's an old story about a man named Uncle Abe. And the entire community, small town, was trying to convert this Uncle Abe. He was not a believer. One day, a longtime friend tackled the problem. Abe, he said, doesn't it bother your heart to know the Lord loves you? Or doesn't it soften your heart, excuse me, not bother, doesn't it soften your heart to know that the Lord loves you? And old Abe scoffed and said, do you aim to tell me that the Lord loves me when he ain't ever knowed me? The old friend thought a moment and said, sadly, Abe, it's a heap easier for the Lord to love you without knowing you than if he ever knowed you like I do. But that's the amazing truth, isn't it? That's the amazing truth. God knows you. God knows me. God knows me inside and out, the good, the bad, the ugly, everything, and he still pursues me. He still pursues you. He knows everything about us. Everything about us. And yet the good news is, he still comes after us. We don't need to run away. We don't need to stay away. We don't need to stay the way we are, no matter how we got where we are. God knows us and still and yet sees so much in us that God sent us the greatest gift possible. Christmas. The good news that God has come looking for us. God put on the flesh and blood of your life and mine. God wrapped himself in the rags of our humanity, stepped right out of heaven, right into a manger or a grocery cart to walk where we walk, and live where we live. In Jesus, God has come looking for you and come looking for me. And that, my friends, is what John the Baptist wants us to hear. Amen.
We stand and sing, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel.
Let us pray. Almighty God, fill our mouths with laughter and our tongues with shouts of joy as we bear witness to the great things that you have done. Give your church a spirit of gladness as we gather and as we are then sent out to share the light. Let the trees of the field sing your praise. Protect your creation and encourage us to do it as well. Keep us grateful for all the gifts of your creation, including oxygen, food, and shelter. You love justice, and you promise your favor to those who are oppressed, brokenhearted, or incarcerated. Grant wisdom and compassion to those who work for public safety and all who work within the justice system, that mercy may increase and that violence may wither away. Give us strength, O God, to pray for our world without ceasing, and provoke us toward love and good deeds for all who are in need. Provide for all without adequate housing, food, employment, or access to health care, and empower us as helpers and advocates wherever possible. Open our hearts to those who serve as truth tellers in our church and in our society. Bless leaders in church and society in their task of proclamation. Amplify voices of peacemakers and advocates. And always hear our prayers. With gratitude, we rejoice in the saints who have gone before us and who witnessed to your life in all circumstances. In them, your spirit was never quenched, not even in death. So through them, teach us always to hold fast to what is good. And Heavenly Father, a prayer request that has just come to Pastor Tim. Our prayers are with Dale Mittler at the passing of his sister Jean, who was recently hospitalized in critical condition in Cincinnati. As part of our Christ Lutheran family, Dale, be sure that our prayers are with you. Hear then these and all our prayers, O God, and restore us with your great and everlasting mercy, as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Several announcements to share with you this morning. First of all, as we celebrate this third Sunday of Advent, we remind you that next Sunday morning, in one service only at 10 o'clock, we will celebrate the fourth Sunday of Advent. And then in the afternoon, we will begin our celebration of the birth of our Lord with 3 o'clock contemporary worship, 5 o'clock family worship, and 7:30 traditional worship, including choir. All three services will include Holy Communion and candlelight. And one note, Chad is still in need of ushers and greeters for the 3 o'clock service. So if any of you can help us with that service and that capacity, please see Chad immediately following the service. The Sunday School Children's Christmas Program will take place right after this service at 10:15 in the gathering place. But I've also been asked to announce that the Forum Adult Sunday School class will meet today in the library. So again, the Forum Adult Sunday School class in the library, and then the Children's Christmas Program in the gathering place. And then just one final note, put it on your calendar for the first full Sunday in January, and that is our next Christ Lutheran Church campaign meeting, and that will follow the 11:10 worship service, January 7th. Those are the announcements. We pray you have a blessed third Advent week in preparation for the birth of our Lord. And now, a beautiful offertory.
Lost in the night do the people yet languish, longing for morning the darkness to vanquish, plaintively heaving a sigh full of anguish. Will not day come soon? Will not day come soon? Must we be vainly awaiting the morrow? Shall those who have light no light let us borrow? Giving no heed to our burden of sorrow, will you help us soon? Will you help us soon? Sorrowing wanderers in darkness yet dwelling, dawn has the day of a radiance excelling. Death's dreaded darkness forever dispelling, Christ is coming soon, Christ is coming soon. Save us soon. Christ is coming
soon. Please stand for confession and Holy Communion. We come before God and each other in a time of confession. O God of love and mercy, you have done great things for all of us, and we should be glad, rejoicing, and celebrating always. However, we often prefer to grumble and point out the unfairness in life. We hide the gift of your light so that we might not draw attention to ourselves and have others think we are weird and out of touch with reality. We resist your spirit and set up roadblocks to you being able to easily work through us. Forgive us. Help us to clear a path for you to use us to share your light in the world. Amen. People of God, rejoice and be glad, for God has indeed done great things for all of us. In the gift of God's Son, Jesus, we are forgiven of our sins. So come to the table this morning, rejoicing in this good news, and then go forth and share God's light in the world. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And we pray together as our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. All those who confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior are welcome to his table. As you come forward for Holy Communion, we invite you to remain at the communion rail as long as you may like, either standing or kneeling. If you would prefer grape juice or gluten-free wafers, just let Pastor Tim or me know. We have that available. No matter where you commune, whether it's here in the sanctuary or online at home, just remember that as you receive the bread and wine, you are receiving the body and blood of Jesus Christ, given and shed for you. The table is ready. Thank you. Please rise for the blessing. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. And now, do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. And may the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
As we sing our last song, we invite anybody to come up and join us and grab a percussion instrument, and especially maybe an extra parent or two today because Miss Lori is not here. So come on up and join us.
God's light in the world. Thanks be to God. And the children's program is immediately following in the gathering place.